Welcome to Top Shelf. My name is David Pierce, and this week we're doing something a little different. Our whole team is in town, which means people from all over the world are here in New York who we never get to see, and a lot of them have really weird gadgets. A lot of that is just our people being weird, and there's also different stuff going on internationally than the US. So we're going to take a look at some of it, starting with you, Thomas Ricker, the Flying Dutchman.
I just decided
that that's your name.
It's not
true. You can't tell me that that's
not
true.
It's not true.
You're from Amsterdam, right? So tell me what you brought. I think your assignment was bring weird things, right?
Yeah, I don't know how weird these are as much as just absolutely beautiful and stunning craftsmanship from a small Dutch company called Minio.
Okay.
They're located about an hour north of Amsterdam, and it's a company just 10 people.
Just 10 people.
And they're
not like outsourcing their manufacturing to somebody else. It's just 10 people who make this.
They do it all themselves.
Wow.
They do all their design, all the craftsmanship. They do a complete line for iPhones or Apple iOS devices right now. So they have the full-size iPad case. They have for the iPhone 5, and you can see a number of the cases here. And they have an iPad mini case like this one, which has just been announced. And
oh, nice.
I don't think you can buy it yet.
Okay, and these, I'm assuming, are astoundingly expensive.
Yes. So this one here, this is called the iPhone, the Minio Book.
This is
absolutely phenomenal. The craftsmanship on this is just beautiful. I don't know if you can see it. I think the top is I'm probably gonna get the wood wrong. It might be a teak, I think, and this is a maple.
Listen, I have nothing to prove you wrong.
And
yet,
it's all,
so just go with it.
So all the wood comes from managed forests, so it's as sustainable as you can expect or as you can hope.
I mean, made of
they
wood,
have to like cut, you, they have to right. cut the tree down, and but they replant and maintain
it. Okay.
But these, are, I mean, there's a magnetic close. Can you hear them?
Yeah.
Can you hear them?
It just sounds
phenomenal. It's phenomenal. But this the craftsmanship is absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, this one I love that it rolls up here, and so. And it's all of these feel like I see these and they seem really precious, but none of them feel particularly breakable or
no. And they're super premium, and it acts like the Apple cover as you would expect it to. They are expensive though.
Yeah.
This one here is $190, which is pretty expensive for a case.
Pretty serious. Yeah.
This one over here is about 90, I think, after the Euro translation. And then the iPad mini one comes in around 80, I think. So not too bad. But this, I mean, it's all handcrafted. It is phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal.
And there's the one they put our logo on, right? Will they do that for anybody, or are we
one
just
of these.
Special? I think it's this guy right here.
Oh, yeah, here. This is, it's the iWood 5.
There's, I feel like there's a lot of things called the iWood 5,
and this
is just one of them.
But this is the Minio Cobra, which is nice because it's like the Shelby Cobra design.
Mm.
It's really beautiful, I think. And you can get all these different colors, and you can actually customize these cases. So this one here, you can have as many strips of different colors as you want, so you can actually do the Cobra in this design. And really unbelievable work.
So does this company just happen to be Dutch, or is there something sort of about where you are from that makes people pay lots of money for iPhone cases? Is that like a thing?
They're just
bespoke, fancy iPhone
expert craftsmen. I mean, think about the wooden shoes, and
that's very true. This is
the next iteration.
The 2013 wooden shoes. I like it.
Okay.
So you have something else too. What? Right,
yeah.
You brought a new gadget.
So this was a Kickstarter project. This is a company called Waka Waka, which means let me see if I can remember this. It's shine bright.
Really?
In Swahili.
Okay. Isn't that also what Fozzie Bear says? Did I make that
and
up?
Rihanna.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's true.
But this is amazing because if you camp, this is a phenomenal little device. It's a light. It's a battery, so you can charge all your USB devices.
Oh, cool.
And it's solar powered, so you can charge it off of the sunlight, or there's a micro USB and you can just charge it off the mains.
So you just leave it on the table all day and hopefully it'll get it. How much power do you get out of this thing?
So this is a 22 milliampere battery inside.
Okay.
It charges, the company claims that if it's pointed directly at the sun at the, was it latitude, longitude of New York City?
Sure.
It'll charge in about 8.5 hours.
Okay, that's not bad.
In my own experience, I've just set it in a room that gets direct sunlight about 3 or 4 hours out of the day, and I just set it there. I didn't adjust it so it turned with the sun or anything.
Right, directly at the
right,
sun.
I just left it in the room, and I came back after a day, and it was about half charged.
Okay.
Now, when this thing's fully charged, it'll recharge an iPhone to 100%, and you'll still have 2 out of 4 dots remaining, which is pretty good.
Yeah, that's a lot. You can get, it's a light too, right?
Yeah,
maybe.
So you touch it once and you get the 4 indicators to see how much battery's left. You touch it again, and then you get the flashlight, and the flashlight is adjustable to multiple levels.
Nice.
And then if you press and hold, let's see if this works, then you get the universal distress, SOS.
That's kind of genius.
Yeah, so it's great for camping. Now,
you're like, crap, my phone battery's dead.
Yeah.
SOS. Sure. And then that's the worst thing that happens.
I mean, you recognize the SOS, right? You recognize that just automatically.
No, I should, but I'm going to learn this now.
Yeah. Now, here's the thing. So the company behind this has a foundation set up. So if you buy this for $69, they put $10 towards a foundation that helps young entrepreneurs develop solar technologies. Mm. They've also, as part of the Kickstarter, they raised $500,000, I think, and that allowed them to send 10,000 of these things to Haiti. Because 3 years after the earthquake, they still have like 300,000 people who are without light. So they sent these down. But they've also, they've had buy one, get one offers and all these things. And so what they do is they ship these things to developing nations. Now, this has two things, right? It has a battery and it has the lights. In like 1.5 billion households around the world still, or no, actually 1.5 billion people around the world do not have electricity at all.
Wow.
And then there's millions more that live in brownout situations.
Right.
So something like this is amazing because, you know, people light their homes with kerosene lamps, which are, there's a health hazard, there's an environmental hazard to that. And in developing nations, they use mobile phones for everything. I mean, we use them for social media and for doing fun things, playing games.
Right.
But these people, they do their banking. Mm-hmm. They do, like, farmers will check crop prices and find the best price for their fields and then use that to sell it. So the mobile phones are incredibly important to them. So to give them a device so that they can charge their mobile and light their homes is amazing.
For not a lot of money.
Yeah.
Either. Yeah.
And one of the other things about this is that these solar panels, they're super efficient. They're like 22% efficiency. And part of that is through a deal with Innovation. It's another Dutch company that makes these power management chips. Mm. So they claim to be the most efficient device of this kind available.
Really?
So yeah, this is just it's Dutch technology, it's Dutch design, and they're very proud of it. And
it's not even wooden shoes.
It's not even wooden shoes.
All right, Thomas Ricker, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Up next, he's from Japan, but he's also from Canada. He's Kanapanese, that's actually what he told me. Jeff Blagden. Jeff, hello.
Hello.
And what in God's name is that?
It's funny you should ask that. this is a TV hand.
I actually could have guessed that.
So, you know how difficult it can be to control the TV.
Sure. This is great. This is like the beginning of your infomercial here. I like this. Now keep going.
So, like, there's a lot of buttons. There's a lot of complexity there. And what the TV hand tries to do is basically solve that problem with some simple gesture-based interface.
Okay.
So,
this is like a universal remote control only crazy.
Yes, only better.
Okay. So what does he do?
So you point it at the TV and just waggle it back and forth.
Okay.
And you can change the volume. You can change the channel if you turn the switch. You can turn the TV on and off.
Just by
flipping
waggling. It up and down. Okay.
Just pure waggle.
I just really like the idea that you're pointing, you're like, no, TV. no, and it turns off.
You show the TV who's boss.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, it works with any TV, or any Japanese TV, I should say. Setup is really easy. You just press and hold the button and... It just pairs.
Yeah. God, I want every remote to be like that. That's awesome.
It's pretty simple, but also powerful. And
so does it do anything else other than it'll change the volume or the channel or turn your TV on and off?
It does. It also. So it lights up, which is really handy if you're like reading at night and you need
a bit
of... Is that
actually bright enough? I guess it is, yeah.
Yeah, if it's dark, I mean, it's pretty bright in here, but you can turn it to throb mode as well, and you can turn it off. And then also...
Please don't call it throb mode.
So when you're reading, it can be a pain to actually like reach down and flip the page. So what you can do is use the rubberized finger here and actually grab a hold of a page, and then you can turn the page.
I will say, that's clearly a lot easier than using your fingers.
It's like pretty...
There's no question.
It's pretty efficient, yeah.
But you were talking before, this is like front and center at a big electronics store.
That's right, yeah, they're pushing it.
This is awesome. So how much does this cost?
It's like $11.
Okay.
So it's dirt cheap.
All right, well, Jeff, thank you so much. Get this thing... Actually, this is mine. I'm kidding. This. Thank you very much.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Later.
Okay, so we've seen beautiful and we've seen... sort of odd. And now I think we're about to get really weird with this man, Sam Byford. And I can see these things. I have no idea what they are.
So
none of them look like gadgets to me.
You'd be surprised.
I know, apparently.
So this is actually a line of merchandise for an app in Japan, which is super popular. It's a messaging app called Line. And it's along the lines of WhatsApp, Viber, these kind
of
things.
Yeah, they're trying to make waves in the US. But is that big in...
It's colossal in Japan. It's like the default mode of communication for a lot of people.
Wow, okay.
And Yeah, it's not really taken off in the US, but one thing that has taken off in a way is the business model of stickers, where you can kind of glorified emoji. So a lot of people like pay money online for new stickers, and like Facebook and Path have sort of done the same thing recently. So in Japan, because the app's so popular, these stickers, the characters have become like Hello Kitty style characters in their own right.
All starting just from the app.
Wow. Yeah. So my favorite is this bear called Brown.
Brown
the bear, yeah.
Sure.
And the thing about him is his face never changes, and he's always put in crazy situations, looking unemotional.
Okay.
It's a he's very
nonplussed.
Yeah. So
whatever's going on.
Because he's popular, you can buy the usual range of merchandise you expect, you know, like cuddly toys and so on. But of course, because it's an app, a lot of them are kind of gadget related. So for example, you can get this little capsule thing for about $1, where you it's got a sticker on it, and you can stick it onto your phone. And then if I put it down, it's like a nice phone stand. And
that's awesome.
And you can see he's unfazed by the crushing
he's
weight
just,
of the Lumia 920.
He's just not worried about it.
Yeah. So
that's like, I need that in life. I don't even use the app, and I need constantly just something to prop. Can you just put heavier things and see if he ever gets angry about it?
I don't think his face would ever change.
No, he's not
he could be propping up anything. But then it gets a little more complex with something like this, which is, it's kind of like a Roomba, like a robot vacuum cleaner, but for your phone. So
what?
Yeah. So let's see. I've got a pretty fingerprinty iPod Touch here. If I put this on.
By the way, I like that you just keep just whipping gadgets out of your pockets here. This is what?
So let's see if he pulls off the edge.
And this, does this work? I guess it kind of does.
Well,
he's like carving beautiful patterns into your fingerprints here.
Yeah, he's just trucking along like it's totally not a big deal. I'm pretty impressed by his, you know, he's not falling off the edge.
That's true.
As to whether the phone is clean, I mean, you can sort of see trails.
Yeah, he's getting there. If you gave him
I feel like if
days
you gave him,
and days.
Yeah, if you gave him a couple of weeks, and he'd get there.
Which, in fairness, is kind of what a Roomba does as well. I think if you give
That's
it
good point.
A day and a half, it'll clean
perhaps,
your entire house.
Perhaps we're expecting too much of Brown.
That's fair. So these are part of just a huge line. I mean, if there's these things, there must be all kinds of
crazy. Oh, yeah, absolutely. And so I got all these at Toy Story in Harajuku. It's maybe the most famous toy store in Japan.
Really? Okay.
And like the entire sort of front entrance area has been taken over by line stuff.
Really?
Like they're sort of painted the characters on the glass doors. And yeah, it's like you can't go to that shop and like miss this range of stuff.
So are there like TV shows and stuff like this?
Yeah, there's an online like anime
kind
of Japanese style animation. And there's like manga and things that go in magazines. It's it's pretty strange just to see this kind of crazy mainstream thing just come basically from an app.
Are other apps like this, or is it just Line that became so popular that people?
There are others. Like, there's one called KakaoTalk, which is from Korea, and Line is actually done by a Korean company, but it was produced in Japan. And KakaoTalk is kind of popular among certain people in Japan, but Line is definitely the biggest.
Fair enough. So what's this? This looks like something you would like that I would give a kid who really wanted a cell phone, but. Didn't get to have a selfie.
That's pretty much what it is. And I feel like because of Line, because the characters are so cute and you can buy the toys everywhere, that's going to result in a lot more kids wanting cell phones.
True.
Or specifically smartphones.
Just to be able to use the characters.
But also in the media, as with a lot of sort of you know, new social technologies and so on, often there's kind of concern in the media about, you know, like letting kids communicate with strangers.
Brown the bear. It's not good for children.
Brown the bear is probably
it's
not good
dangerous.
For children. So you can get this, which is the Linetown MyTouch. It is basically a fake phone.
Oh, wow.
And it has apps. The control system is out of control. It's like this. It's this like touch panel thing where you like
swipe.
This looks
like an Android phone from 2 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, the screen might be a little better, but it's not Pentile. But yeah, so you can do things like you can play games, you can play rock, paper, scissors with the characters, and if you win, you get more stickers to send.
Yeah.
And you can send stickers and messages to like friends who also have one of these by like touching the phone together. So it's kind of it's sort of an evil scheme to get kids into falling in love with the characters.
So are toys in general this high tech? I mean, like this is a very technologically advanced toy.
It kind of is, isn't it?
You can touch phones together and they connect like that.
So this costs about $70, and it's which is pretty cheap, I guess. But I mean, you know, products like this, the price is falling all the time, not only outside toys. It's I'd say this is definitely at the upper end of like what you would just casually give a kid.
Fair enough, I guess.
But then again, in Japan, I mean, it's hard to see a kid that doesn't have like a Nintendo DS or anything. So it's not really out of that range. I guess I would say the functionality is a little limited beyond.
I guess that's why they give you the smartphone. Once you turn 12.
Well, you graduate, yeah. But yeah. It's pretty interesting.
That's awesome.
If nothing else.
So do you use Line? Is that
I do, yeah, absolutely.
What you use to communicate with everybody?
It's not everybody, but like, I mean, my girlfriend, for example, just we write in Line.
Mm-hmm. And just to be able to communicate using Brown the Bear.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Awesome. Sam, thank you very much. And Brown the Bear, I guess, thank you as well.
Thank you.
All right, and that's our show. Thanks so much to Sam Byford and Thomas Ricker and Jeff Blagden for being here and our whole international crew for liking and buying very strange gadgets. We'll be back next week, and we'll see you then.